Hello everyone. Hope all are doing good. So in today's session, we will be discussing about the next concept in the paper 8, that is proteins. So to start with, let us start with one of the class that comes under proteins, that is alpha amino acids. Coming to the definition, we know that proteins are made up of long chain of amino acids. Why preferably we call these acids as alpha amino acids? Because you can see in this structure, you have a carbon which is in turn attached to an amino group, and it is also in turn attached to a carboxyl group. Do you find other carbon atom? No. The structure has only one carbon atom, so this carbon becomes alpha carbon, which is in turn attached to amino group, even to the carboxyl group, and this R indicates the presence of a functional group or a side chain. So the carbon, which is alpha in nature, it is in turn attached to a carboxyl group as well as amino group. Therefore, these amino acids are referred as alpha amino acids. The common property of all proteins is that they consist of long chains of alpha amino acids, and this is the structure. The alpha amino acids are so called because the alpha carbon atom in the molecule carries an amino group. The alpha carbon atom also carries a carboxyl group. That's the reason we call the amino acids as alpha amino acids. Coming to the classification of amino acids, amino acids are classified in two categories. One is based on the polarity of the R group that is attached to the carbon, and next based on the essentiality of the amino acids to the human body. So to go with, first we shall go with the classification of amino acids based on the polarity of R group that is attached to the carbon. So there are four main classes of amino acids based on the polarity of the R group, that is the interaction of the R group with water molecules at the physiological pH. Physiological pH in the sense the pH of the body, that is the neutral pH. So we have four such classes. First one, amino acids with non-polar side chain. Second, amino acids with uncharged polar side chain, and the third, amino acids with polar but negatively charged R group, and the last, amino acids with polar but positively charged R group. So this is about the first group. These amino acids have a non-polar hydrophobic side chain. If you observe these two structures, one is your alanine amino acid and the other is your leucine. Apart from NH2 group as well as COOH group, you can observe CH3 groups that are attached to alanine as well as the leucine. These CH3 group, nothing but the R group, they are non-polar hydrophobic groups. That's the reason these examples come under amino acids with non-polar R group or side chain. They do not provide protons or participate in hydrogen or ionic bonding, because CH3, you can see the carbon has got its tetravalency, so it's not taking part in any kind of reactions. And the examples we have, alanine, valine, leucine, isoleucine, proline, phenylalanine, tryptophan, and methionine. These are some examples that come under the first class of amino acids. Next, we have amino acids with uncharged polar side chains. These amino acids are most soluble in water. They are hydrophilic in nature. The functional groups can make hydrogen bonds with water. If you just observe these examples, glycine. In glycine, you have a hydrogen that is attached to CH, which acts as R group. And in case of serine, you have OH group, which acts as a alkyl or R side chain attached to the carbon. So here OH can take hydrogen and this H can take up OH. They in turn form water. And examples, we have glycine, serine, threonine, tyrosine, cysteine, asparagine, and glutamine. Next class, amino acids with polar negatively charged side chain. These amino acids will have a net negative charge at neutral pH. Examples, we have aspartic acid and glutamic acids. See, these acids can be easily analyzed because apart from one COOH group and NH2 group, they have one more COOH group that is attached to the ketonic group. In the last class, we have amino acids with polar positively charged side chain. These amino acids will have a net positive charge at pH 7. They accept protons. Examples are lysine and arginine as well as histidine. Even arginine comes under the fourth class of amino acid. Lysine contains a second amino group at third position on the aliphatic side chain. Arginine contains a positively charged gonadino group. These NH and NH2 groups are referred as gonadino group, and you have NH2 group here. This acts as positively charged side chain and they can accept protons. This is about the classification of amino acids based on the polarity of R group. And even I was telling that there's one more classification based on the essentiality of amino acids. So they are classified as essential amino acids and non-essential amino acids. Hope you still remember I was discussing these concepts under fatty acids, like essential as well as non-essential fatty acids. So essential amino acids are those acids which cannot be synthesized by the body but still are required by the body. And non-essential amino acids are those amino acids which can be synthesized by the body. Essential amino acids, since they are not synthesized, they need to be included in the diet. But non-essential, since they are synthesized by the body, you do not include them in the diet. Essential amino acids are also referred as indispensable. Dispensable meaning can be replaced. Since non-essential amino acids are synthesized by the body, you can replace them. But since essential amino acids are not synthesized by the body, they are irreplaceable or indispensable. And coming to the production, human beings, we know that we have around 20 amino acids. Among that 20 amino acids, humans cannot synthesize 9 of the amino acids. And those 9 are histidine, isoleucine, leucine, lysine, methionine, phenylalanine, threonine, tryptophan, as well as valine. So these are the 9 amino acids which remain essential since they are not synthesized by the body. Then coming to the non-essential amino acids, human beings or human body can produce around 11 of the amino acids among 20. And they are alanine, aspargine, aspartic acid, cysteine, glutamic acid, glutamine, glycine, proline, serine, as well as tyrosine. Next, we shall go with the reaction of alpha amino acids. First, we shall go with reaction with alcohol. Alpha, A means alpha amino acids form esters when heated with alcohols using dry hydrogen chloride as a catalyst. And here is the reaction where you can observe. This is your alpha amino acid, which is undergoing esterification in the presence of dry HCl, where Cl gets attached to the NH3 group and H gets attached to the COH group, in turn forming an ester, releasing a molecule of water. And here HCl acts as a catalyst. Next, we have reaction with nitrous acid. HNO3 is your nitric acid. If you remove one oxygen, it becomes nitrous acid. Alpha amino acids react with nitrous acid at room temperature, producing hydroxy acid. Where OH is attached to CH group, such compounds are referred as hydroxy acids, releasing a molecule of water and nitrogen gas. Next, we have reaction of alpha amino acid with ninhydrin. Coming to the ninhydrin, it is one of the classical reagents which is used for detection of amino acids. This ninhydrin is most of the times used to detect the presence of amino acids. Whenever ninhydrin reacts with any compound, if that compound is an amino acid, then that ninhydrin gets converted into a purple colored compound referred as Roux-Munn's purple. This reaction requires around 2 to 5 minutes at temperature of about 100 degrees Celsius. But there is one amino acid referred as proline, which upon reaction with ninhydrin gives a yellow colored liquid or a compound, and it absorbs at a wavelength of 440 nanometer. But other amino acids which get converted into purple color, they absorb at a wavelength of around 570 nanometer. So all amino acids gives a purple colored compound referred as Roux-Munn's color on reaction with ninhydrin, except proline, which gives a yellow colored liquid which absorbs at 440 nanometer. Next, we have classification of proteins. Proteins are classified on three bases. One is based on structure, second based on composition, and third based on biological function. Coming to the classification based on structure, based on structure, the proteins are classified into three classes, that is fibrous proteins, globular proteins, and intermediate proteins. Here you have a diagrammatic representation of all the three proteins that come under the first category, that is based on structure. You have a collagen and a hemoglobin, and here you have an intermediate filament. Collagen, it's a type of fibrous protein, and your hemoglobin, it's a type of your globular proteins. So let us discuss one by one. Coming to the fibrous protein, can be defined as polypeptide chains where they lie parallel to each other to form a fiber. In case of fibrous proteins, polypeptide chains, they lie parallel to each other to form a fiber. You can see here, these are the polypeptide chains which are lying parallel to each other, giving rise to a fiber-like structure. Coming to the globular proteins, here the polypeptide chains, they intermix or they intertwine with each other to form a spherical shape structures. Coming to the fibrous proteins, they are water insoluble. They don't get dissolved in water, but your globular proteins are water soluble. Coming to the fibrous proteins, they are very stable to pH as well as the temperature, but the globular proteins, they are very much sensible to the pH as well as temperature. A slight change in pH or temperature can make the proteins to undergo denaturation. Denaturation is a process where they lose their structure as well as the working capacity. I shall repeat. Fibrous proteins, they are made up of polypeptide chains which run parallel to each other, giving rise to a fiber-like structure. Coming to the globular proteins, here the polypeptide chains are intertwined to each other, giving rise to a spherical shape. The fibrous proteins are water insoluble. They are not that sensitive to water. They don't dissolve in water, but your globular proteins are water soluble. They get dissolved in water. Fibrous proteins, they are very stable to pH as well as temperature changes, but your globular proteins are very much sensitive to notable changes in pH as well as temperature. As I said, they do undergo denaturation at high temperatures where the proteins lose their property as well as the working conditions. Coming to the activity of the fibers as well as the globular proteins. Globular proteins are very much active in the biological system. They act as enzymes. Globular proteins can act as enzymes. Examples, maltase and invertase. They can even act as hormones. Example, insulin. Globular proteins can also act as antibodies like gamma globulin. And they can also act as transport proteins. What we have hemoglobin here, the structure, what you're observing, it's a structure of hemoglobin, which is an example for globular protein, which helps in the transport process. Here you have fibrous protein. They are not that active in the biological system, but still they are the major components of tissues like keratin in skin, nail, hairs, as well as wool. And they are the collagen that is found in the tendon and fibrin that are found in silk, as well as they are the myosin that are found in muscles. These are about the differences between the fibers as well as the globular proteins. Then coming to the intermediate proteins, which are also referred as intermediate filaments, are the key structural proteins that form the cytoskeleton. They comprise a large protein family that includes about 73 unique gene products. Perhaps the most important function of the intermediate filament proteins, that is IFS, is to provide mechanical support for the plasma membrane. Hope I have made this clear. Next, we have classification of protein based on biological function. Based on biological function, the proteins can act as enzymes, they can act as hormones, they can act as transport agents, they can, even act as enzymes. First, structural proteins, they strengthen, support, or protect biological structures like collagen, which is a major component of tendon, cartilage, a kind of muscle, skin, teeth, bone, etc., and alpha keratin present in hair, nail, feather, etc. Then transport proteins, they carry specific substances from one part of the body or cell to another. Example, hemoglobin, as I discussed in the previous slide. They transport oxygen, and the lipoproteins, which are specifically meant to transport lipids. Contractile or motile proteins. Motile means which are able to move. These proteins enable cells to contract, to change shape, or to move about. So these proteins are helpful in changing the shape with respect to the condition of the body or to move about the bone. Example, we have actin and myosin. These are the two kind of proteins that are found in the muscles, which helps in contraction and relaxation of the muscles. Catalytic proteins, like enzymes, they catalyze virtually all chemical reactions in living organisms. Example, we have amylase and pepsin. Hope you know about the pepsin acid that is found in the stomach, which helps in bringing about the digestion properly. Then the last, we have regulatory protein, that is hormones. These are the proteins which control and regulate cellular activity. Example, insulin, glucagon, vasopressin, etc. You know that insulin, it helps in maintaining the blood glucose level in the body, and even the glucagon as well as the vasopressin. And I'm left with one more classification that is based on the composition. So I just request you people to go through this and just make notes of your own. That is based on composition. You have two classes. One is simple protein and the other you have conjugated proteins. You need not spend much time on this. Just get each points for each of the types with the example. Well, I have made things clear. I hope so. So let us meet in the next session with the concept, that is level of organization of protein, as well as denaturation and renaturation of proteins. Till then, Take care. See you. Bye-bye. Hello everyone, hope all are doing good. So in our previous lecture, we were discussing about the concept that is alpha amino acids, the introduction, their structure, and the classification of alpha amino acids into several groups based on the polarity of R groups, and even the classification as essential and non-essential amino acids. And even we discussed the reactions of amino acids with some reagents, as well as the classification of proteins based on structure, composition, as well as the biological importance. So in our today's session, we'll be talking about or discussing about the levels of organization of proteins. Proteins, as we know, are large, extraordinarily complex molecules. Due to their complex nature, their polypeptide chains are not simply linear. Instead, they are folded into compact shapes, which are coiled. Sometimes they might be in zigzag manner, sometimes with bends, or sometimes with loops. This all complexity is because of the levels of organization that we come across proteins. So depending on the complexity, the proteins may have up to four levels of structure, namely primary structure, secondary structure. Under secondary structure, we have three substructures: alpha helix, beta pleated sheath, and the third is triple helix. Next, we have tertiary structure, and at the end, we have quaternary structure. So these are the four levels of organization that we come across. Proteins, this is how the proteins are exactly made. First, they undergo the primary, later they come to secondary, then the tertiary, and at the end, we have the quaternary structure. So let us discuss one by one. Here we have the primary structure. Primary structure, it's nothing but the unique sequence of amino acids in a linear way. And you can see the colored balls are your amino acids, and they each are held, they are covalently held by peptide bonds. And each amino acid in this polypeptide chain are referred as residues. Residues are nothing but the small monomer units, which in turn give rise to a polymeric chain. So here you can see the enlarged view. You have each amino acids, which are in turn linked to each other by a peptide bond. And each amino acid has two terminal ends. One is the amino end, other is the carboxyl end. So one amino end will be in turn connected through peptide bond to a carboxyl end. The primary structure, nothing but a linear sequence of amino acids, which in turn gives rise to primary structure. And these amino acids are covalently held with the help of a peptide bonds, and we call them as residues. Each amino acid in this polypeptide chain are referred as residues. The importance of the primary structure is that a single change in the primary structure of a protein can bring a drastic change in the biological function. For example, let me consider hemoglobin. We know that hemoglobin, it is a tetramer, in the sense it has got four monomer units, and these four monomer subunits in turn give rise to hemoglobin. And the sixth amino acid in one of the subunit is glutamic acid. This is the normal composition of hemoglobin, which is a tetramer, and the sixth amino acid, it is nothing but the glutamic acid. But in the case of patients who are suffering from sickle cell anemia, sickle cell anemia, it's a condition where the biconcave structure of the red blood cells are distorted, or they are alike from the normal hemoglobin shape. This is because the sixth amino acid, that is glutamic acid, it is being replaced by an amino acid referred as valine. So a small change in the subunit of the amino acid may in turn give rise to some dysfunctional changes like sickle cell anemia. And the sickle cell anemia, because of this, the RBCs, they lose their tendency to bind to the oxygen efficiently, which in turn leads to the block of the blood capillaries, as well as the block of the blood circulation, and even sometimes it causes pain and the organ damage. And if the sickle cell anemia goes to a extended condition, it is referred as anemia. Next, we have secondary structure. Secondary structure is nothing but the three-dimensional form of local segments of proteins. And under secondary structure, the primary structure is nothing but a single dimensional, where the subunits are held by peptide bonds in a linear way. But in case of secondary structure, they are in a three-dimensional form. So under secondary structure, we have alpha helices as well as the beta pleated sheets. So here you can see in the diagram, the first one, which is the alpha helix, it somewhat resembles the telephone cord. If people might have seen the telephone cord, in the same way, these the peptide chains have been linked. In case of your beta pleated sheets, the chains, the polypeptide chains are coiled, and you can see they are held by some intramolecular hydrogen bond. We shall discuss each one briefly. So here we have alpha helix. They are nothing but rigid rod-like spiral structure. As I said, they resemble the telephone cord. Structures were proposed in the early 1950s by scientists, that is Linus Pauling and Robert Covey. And these structures were proposed by their studies on a fibrous protein referred as alpha keratin. So these alpha helix are majorly or abundantly found in a fibrous protein referred as alpha keratin. And this helix is stabilized by hydrogen bonds. You can find these dashed lines, which are indicated by yellow color. They indicate or represent the hydrogen bonds that are formed between the hydrogen of ammonia group, as well as the highly electronegative oxygen of the carboxyl group. And here you can observe the formation of hydrogen bond. It takes place between hydrogen of one amino acid and the carboxyl group of the other amino acid. And the stability is mainly because of the hydrogen bonds. And the helix has 3.6 amino acids per turn. Each turn of this helix contains 3.6 amino acids. And the structure is right-handed in the sense it coils in a clockwise direction. Next, we have beta sheet. Again, you can observe the polypeptide chains are they are just placed in the form of sheet-like structure. It's a sheet-like stretched chain. In a single polypeptide, the chains fold back on itself, forming sheet-like structure. So here you can see the sheet has formed a fold back, giving rise to a sheet-like structure. If two or more polypeptide chains are involved, they lay side by side, forming sheet-like structure. So here you have one polypeptide chain which is bent. If you found one more polypeptide chain next to this, again they come close to each other, forming or giving rise to a sheet-like structure. This structure is stabilized by interchain or intrachain hydrogen bonds. So here you can say this is a single polypeptide chain which is bent. So here you can see the formation of hydrogen bond between H of amino group and the oxygen of a carboxyl group. So this hydrogen bonding is between a single polypeptide chain. Therefore, I consider it as intrachain hydrogen bond. If I find one more polypeptide chain next to this chain, and hydrogen of this chain, if it is bonded to the carboxyl of the next chain, then I can consider it to be a interchain hydrogen bond. If N terminals are aligned on one side, then it is called a parallel beta sheet, and if two polypeptide chains run in opposite direction, then it is called anti-parallel beta sheet. See here, this end or this terminal is referred as N terminal, that is amino terminal, and this terminal is referred as carboxyl terminal. If you find two polypeptide chains running where both the terminal ends are similar, like you have two polypeptide chains and here you have ammonia and even here you have ammonia, and this N terminal has carboxyl and again this N terminal has carboxyl, then those two chains are referred as parallel beta sheet. If you have one polypeptide chain where the above terminal is ammonia and the below terminal is carboxyl, and the next chain if you have a carboxyl in the above end and the amino group in the below end, then I can consider the sheet as anti-parallel beta sheet. And this is how the combined second structure looks. So here this is the alpha helical structure. You can see it is right-handed where the coil twists in a clockwise direction, and here you can see the formation of hydrogen bond between the hydrogen of amino group as well as the carboxyl of the oxygen of the carboxyl group. And this is the beta bleated sheet. So you have two polypeptide chains which are running next to each other, and again you can find the formation of hydrogen bonds. If these two polypeptide chains are of different protein, then it is interchain hydrogen bonding, or if this chain is folded, then it can be considered as intrachain hydrogen bonding. This hydrogen bonding, it's nothing, it gives stability to this helices. Again, under secondary structure, we have a triple helix of collagen. This is triple helix of collagen because triple helix, again, it's a secondary structure which is majorly found in collagen. Collagen, again, is the name of the protein. So most abundant protein in humans, considered to be the structural protein of connective tissues like bone, cartilage, tendon, aorta, and skin. So connective tissues are those tissues which form a bridge between two organ systems, like you have bone and you have muscle. So I need to attach this muscle to the bone. So we need some connective tissue which links the muscle to the bone. So collagen is that connective tissue which helps in binding, or cartilage is that binding tissue which helps in binding muscle to the bone. Again, tendon is again one such binding tissue which helps in binding the muscles to the bones. Cartilage is also found near the joint areas, and coming to the skin and aorta, we know that fine. And this collagen, it makes up about 30% of the body's protein. If you have 100% of protein, among that 100%, 30% of the protein is made up of collagen. And you can see there are three such polypeptide chains which are running twisted to each other, right? In case of primary structure, you have only one polypeptide chain which is running linearly, no bend or no curves, right? And in case of secondary structure, you have again a single polypeptide chain. It can be in the form of alpha helix where it is resembling the telephone cord where it is twisted, or it can be in a pleated form where the polypeptide chain might have some loops and bends. But in case of your triple helix of collagen, you find three such polypeptide chains which are twisted to each other, are held to each other due to some interactions. We shall discuss about those interactions. So each unit is referred as tropocollagen. In case of your collagen, you can see three polypeptide chains which are intertwined to each other and running parallel to each other. So this is the composition of collagen. Glycine makes up about 1/3 of the amino acid residues, while proline and hydroxyproline may account for as much as 30%. So your collagen is made up of repetitive units like glycine, hydroxyproline, and proline. So the composition of collagen is glycine, which makes about the major portion of the collagen, and hydroxyproline as well as proline, they make up about 30% of the remaining composition. And the sequence, it goes like this: glycine, X, and Y. So you have glycine here, and X is nothing but your proline, and Y nothing but your hydroxyproline. proline. But in some cases, this glycine can be replaced by alanine, but in only some rare cases. Well, after primary, secondary, we are coming to the tertiary structure. Protein needs to adapt a final and stable tertiary or the three-dimensional shape in order to function properly. The tertiary structure of a protein is the arrangement of the secondary structures into the final three-dimensional shape. So, to understand this tertiary, you should have a good knowledge of what are primary structures and what are secondary structures. In case of primary, you can see only the linear polypeptide chains. And in case of secondary, you can see you have a single unit. It can be in helix form, or three single units can be spiral and running together, or you can have the bent structure, that is the beta pleated sheets. Okay, but here it is a three-dimensional arrangement. It's not necessary that they go in a straight line or in a vertical manner. They can be coiled in all the three dimensions. Each unique sequence of amino acids give rise to a unique protein type with a unique shape and functions. So we can consider that the tertiary structures, they can occur in form of globular proteins. You might have seen those globular proteins which are not fibrous in nature. They have some messy structure, like you have some ends running in some other direction and the terminal end running in some other direction. So it's like messy. So the tertiary structures, it's nothing but they gave rise to some globular proteins because they are not running in a linear direction. They are spread in all the three directions. And let us discuss about some of the forces which stabilize the tertiary structure. So we have hydrophobic interactions, ionic interactions, hydrogen bond, and the covalent bonds. That is, particularly we are considering the disulfide bridge. So under hydrophobic interactions occurs between hydrophobic R groups, which are repelled by water. And under ionic interactions, it occurs between the positive end of basic amino acid and the negative end of acidic amino acid. Hydrogen bond, we know that it's formed between R groups of amino acids brought close together while they undergo folding. And the covalent bonds, it is disulfide bridge, it's commonly found in the CH2SH group of cysteine. These groups react to form disulfide bridges. Here you have the pictorial representation of all kinds of the forces that stabilize the tertiary structure. So here you have hydrogen bond, which is formed between the oxygen of the carboxyl as well as the hydrogen of some alkyl group. Then you have hydrophobic interactions, which is formed between R groups of amino acids. Then, as I said, disulfide bridge, which occurs among CH2SH group of cysteine. Then you have ionic bond, which occurs between positively and negatively charged atoms that come across in amino acids. So these all four interactions, they help in making sure that this three-dimensional structure is stabilized, because they're not a unidirectional, they run in all the three directions. So it's very important for some forces to act, making sure that this three-dimensional structure is stabilized, because the proteins act very properly in its tertiary structure, and primary and secondary, they do act as bridging for the tertiary structure. Well, last we have the quaternary structure. All proteins have primary, secondary, and tertiary structure, but some proteins are made up of more than one amino acid chain, that is polypeptide chain, and it gives rise to a quaternary structure. These multi-chain proteins are held together with the same forces as the tertiary forces. So here the quaternary structures are also stabilized by the same forces what we discussed in tertiary, that is hydrogen, ionic, then hydrophobic as well as the disulfide bridges. So this is the quaternary structure. Do you remember anything by looking into these subunits or looking into this heme group? Yes, obviously, yeah, hemoglobin, it's nothing but a quaternary structure, or it's a globular protein. So in hemoglobin, you come across four subunits. So it's a quaternary structure. You have two beta units and you have two alpha helices, which are held together by these interactions, like hydrophobic, and we have ionic, and we have disulfide interactions. Okay. So this is just a review or a flow chart to know what exactly each structure has to do. So you have a primary structure. All amino acids are linearly placed via peptide bonds. So primary structure is determined by the sequence of amino acids. And under secondary structure, we have the main two categories, that is alpha helix and the pleated sheet. And later we have that triple helix form of collagen. Second structure occurs when the amino acids are linked by hydrogen bonds. Coming to tertiary structure, is formed when alpha helices and beta sheets are held together by weak interactions. That is, you have read those four interactions, and because of those four interactions, we come across the tertiary structure and they are stabilized. Later, we go to the quaternary structures where you have many subunits which are combined together because of those interactions that we discussed in the tertiary structure. And the best example for quaternary structure, we have hemoglobin, which has got four subunits. Two of the subunits are referred as alpha chains, which contain 141 amino acids, and the remaining two subunits are referred as beta chains, which do contain 146 amino acid residues or amino acids in their chain. And this arrangement of four subunits with respect to each other is called the quaternary structure of hemoglobin. And this quaternary structure, it enables the hemoglobin to work cooperatively. That is, it helps in binding the oxygen and in the transportation of oxygen. Well, this is the diagrammatic representation of all the levels of organization of proteins. You have primary structure. Later, you have the secondary. Under secondary, I have alpha form and I have beta form. Here you can see alpha form where they just run in a helical format or in the cord-like format. And here you can see they are bent. The single polypeptide chain is bent and each are held by the hydrogen bonds. And hydrogen bonds can be intra or inter depending on the number of polypeptide chains. And later they just form sheath-like structure. And later we have the tertiary structure. And then we go to the quaternary structure where they give us to globular proteins. Hope I have made this thing clear. And this is a review of protein structure. Proteins are long chains of amino acids that fold into complex three-dimensional shapes. Proteins come in an almost endless array of shapes and sizes, each type acting like a specialized molecular machine that performs a specific microscopic task. Yes, obviously. Primary structure, as I said, it's a specific order of amino acids in a peptide chain. And we know that there are about 20 different amino acids and they are held in this chain via polypeptide bonds. Coming to the secondary structure, we have alpha helices and beta pleated sheaths. Then we have tertiary structure, it's the final shape of an entire amino acid. This shape is directly related to the function of the protein. Entire means you have a single amino acid, which can be in a linear form or can be in alpha helix or beta created form, or later it can go to a three-dimensional form. Then we have quaternary, where you come across many number of amino acid chains, right, forming a complex protein like your hemoglobin. This is about the review of protein structure. Well, coming to the last concept, denaturation and renaturation of proteins. Denaturation, disruption of the native conformation of a protein, is called denaturation. We know that proteins, once they lose their conformation or a three-dimensional structure, they lose their biological or the enzymatic activity, and that can be considered to be the ideal form, right? So denaturation is a process where the normal protein loses its enzymatic or the biological activity due to some forces. So here you can see this is the normal protein where it has got some alpha helical structure and they are called giving rise to a tertiary form, right? It has undergone denaturation and here you can see it has come to the primary structure where the hydrogen bonds have been broken. So this protein has lost its enzymatic activity. But this protein which has lost its activity can be again made to work enzymatically or biologically by a process referred as renaturation, where you are helping this denatured protein to gain its activity or come back to its original form. So this renaturation refers to the reconstruction of a protein or nucleic acid such as DNA to their original form, especially after denaturation. So renaturation is the reverse of denaturation. So denaturation, it's nothing but where a normal protein loses its native conformation and while it also loses its biological activity. This is how the protein looks after the denaturation or the disruption. But this disrupted protein can again be brought back to the normal condition by a process referred as renaturation. And this denaturation of proteins is mainly caused because of first one, strong acids or bases, second one, heat, third, mechanical agitation, fourth, because of the presence of some reagents like urea and beta mercaptor ethanol, five, due to some organic solvents, sixth, because of detergents. I shall repeat. Denaturation is caused by some of the factors. First one might be because of strong acids or bases. Second, when they're exposed to heat. Third, when they're exposed to mechanical constriction. Next, might be because of the presence of reagents like urea and mercaptor ethanol. Next, might be because of the organic solvent or might be because of the presence of any detergent. But you should remember one thing. They may lose their three-dimensional structure. They may lose the hydrogen bonds that are formed or held between the amino acids, but the peptide bonds are not broken during denaturation. So the amino acids are still held by peptide bonds, but may not be in its three-dimensional format and might have lost its biological activity. So in your syllabus, you have a process of renaturation of protein by Anfinsen experiment. This experiment is named after its discoverer, that is Anfinsen, Christian Anfinsen. He demonstrated that the tertiary structure of a protein can be determined by its primary structure. He treated ribonucleus, which is a form of protein because it is synthesized from DNA, right? With urea and a reducing agent to mercaptor ethanol to denature it. So here you have a native ribonucleus in its original form and I'm making use of reducing agent, that is 2-mercaptor ethanol. This reducing agent, it breaks all kind of hydrogen bonds that are held between the amino acid. This is how we are reduced ribonucleus looks. And after heating this protein in the presence of urea, you can see the three-dimensional structure is lost. Your ribonucleus now comes to a unfolded format. So you have a native ribonucleus, which undergoes reduction in the presence of reducing agent, that is 2-mercaptor ethanol. You can see the hydrogen bonds, which are stabilizing the tertiary structures, have lost. And again, upon heating or on addition of urea, you can see the tertiary structure has been lost. And you come to a primary protein structure, which is in its inactive state. But again, it can be regained or brought back to its original condition. How? So, Anfinsen, what he did, he then dialyzed away these reagents and the protein regained its active form. What he did, he again removed the urea from this solution. Then he left in the air for some time. So after some time, he saw that this ribonucleus has gained its property or the enzymatic activity again, and it has come to its native tertiary structure. So, hope I have made things clear. So under proteins, we have discussed the alpha amino acids, their classification and the properties, as well as the reactions of amino acids. And even we discussed the classification of proteins. And in today's sessions, we discussed the levels of organization of protein, that is how exactly a protein is built. So under that levels, we have we discussed primary, secondary. Under secondary, we discussed alpha, beta pleated, as well as the triple helix, under which we discussed the collagen and tertiary structure and the forces stabilizing them. And at end, we discussed the quaternary. We also discussed how a protein can be disrupted and how it can be brought back to its original condition. Hope I have made things clear. So in our next session, we shall start with our next concept in the unit 3, that is biological oxidation, the most important concept. So till then, take care. Bye-bye.